Hello, supply chain friends. So last week I posted a poll on both LinkedIn and YouTube asking all of you about which topics do you want to see more videos on. And I gave four options. One of them was AI usage in supply chain. And there was another one about free courses, supply chain job interviews, and how to upskill on SAP, IBP. And on both the platforms, I got a lot of responses about creating content on AI applications in supply chain. So I decided to create a two-part video series where in this first part, I will talk about why is AI not really a new concept in supply chain? What are some of the watchouts and what are the top three examples of generative AI implementation in supply chain? And in the next video, we will talk about the same thing, but for agentic AI. My name is Jamil Hai, and I've been working in supply chain management positions across South Asia, Middle East, and North America for the last 20 years. And my mission is to help supply chain professionals like you build real life skills for your job and career that they don't teach you in college. And if you are preparing for a supply chain job interview anytime soon, you should definitely book a session with me because I am going to take your resume, the job description you're applying for, and based on a combination of those two and my 20 years of experience, we'll give you some laser guided tips and tricks which will maximize your chances of success. So go ahead now and book your session. So first of all, I want to talk a little bit about why AI is not really a new concept in supply chain. And in fact, supply chain was one of the first adopter industries of AI. So I want to compartmentalize AI into four parts, right? The first one was the perception AI. Perception AI was things like document recognition. Some of you may remember that back in the day, there was something called optical character recognition where the scanner would be able to identify the characters when you upload, like say a static like photocopy or something like that. So supply chain was one of the early adopters of that technology because there was a lot of usage of things like you upload, let's say a bill of lading, and it's going to automatically pull the BOL number or the commercial invoice number, and it's going to load it into an ERP system. So that technology of perception AI has been in use for quite a while. Another example of perception AI, which has been in use since the 1990s, is things like temperature control in trucks, where it would continuously send you messages about the temperature in the trucks, or you could also be monitoring the fact that how long is the driver taking a break, because there are certain requirements and regulations in countries, especially like in the US, where the driver has to take a break after every X number of hours because the distances are so long. So that kind of technology has been in use for a very long, long time. Then comes the second one, which is the physical AI, which is the use of AI in robotics. And even that has been in use in supply chain for a long time now. I think Amazon acquired the famous Kiva robots. An example of that you see on the screen. I know these are not exactly the Kiva robots, but they have been in use since almost 2012, where instead of an operator going to pick the product from the shelf, Amazon brought in this breakthrough concept that the product will come to the operator, and that has been in use for a long time. And some of these Kiva robots or the later generations are super intelligent, and they are using some of that AI algorithms as well. So that has been in place since 2012. And now what is creating a lot of this buzz about AI is this new thing called generative AI. Things like what you see in ChatGPT, where you put a prompt and then it very intelligently goes through the internet and does all the research and gives you search results, which are way more smarter than what your classical Google search used to look like at one point in time. So that is something which is now taking a lot of shape, so especially since 2015. And some of the applications we will see in this video are dynamic routing, iterative inventory optimization, procurement automation, and so on and so forth. And then the next concept is the agentic AI, which has been more and more tested and is in usage in supply chain. Almost, I would say, after 2020, where we are talking about dynamic sourcing, automated customer services, AI chatbots, and those kind of things. Now, one of the watchouts when you think about AI implementation in supply chain is that 85%, and this is not my data, this is Gartner's data, 85% of initiatives in supply chain for AI fail. And there are a bunch of reasons that you see on this graphic here. So there could be things like unclear objectives. Sometimes people just want to do AI for the sake of doing AI. And that's not really an objective. You have to define a clear business problem And that will really, you know, any real business problem in supply chain will become a good candidate for an AI solve. Another one is incompetent leadership or unrealistic expectations that you are expecting that AI is going to come and change the world for you. It's not going to happen overnight. So putting too many expectations on one project can be very dangerous as well, and it's just very common. Another one is poor change management, which, by the way, doesn't only apply to AI. Any new project, any new technology change, or any new even a non-technology change you're going to bring in into an organization, you have to do very good change management. And if you fail to do that, that could be a reason for failure as well. Poor data quality, of course, you know, the famous saying, garbage in, garbage out, always is applicable, especially in supply chain. If you provide data which is incorrect or it is inaccurate, then you are going to get inaccurate output, no matter whether you are using AI or any other technological solution. So there are like these, some of the reasons. And then we also have to be very, very careful. There is a lot of scamming going around in the AI world as well.
You may have heard
this famous notorious example of builder.ai, where they were selling it as an AI solution tool where you could actually build a website by providing some prompts. But in reality, there was no AI back at work. There were a bunch of engineers working in offshore sites, especially in India. They were trying to do the coding. So that's actually a watch out, that because AI is such a buzzword right now, you could be scammed easily. So make sure that whatever solutions you are exploring are truly AI solutions, and they are not some bunch of people working laborious hours in an offshore site. Okay, so now let's move to the top three generative AI examples for supply chain. And the first one I want to talk about is the dynamic routing and last mile logistics example from DHL. Now, last mile delivery is perhaps the biggest pain point in any e-commerce or direct-to-consumer model. And of course, DHL being one of the key suppliers of last mile delivery, of course, suffers from that as well. Up to 50% of your logistics cost can sit in your last mile delivery. Why is that the case? I mean, we can, of course, cover this in a separate video. And if you have any requests or questions around that, please let me know in chat. However, because when it comes to last mile delivery, you are actually losing that scale of volume, right? Because imagine, let's say you're a manufacturer, you ship tons of products in big trucks to, let's say, an Amazon warehouse, but then Amazon has to package them out and one by one send it to different home addresses, right? That is why their last mile delivery is so expensive. So in this example, that was the cost challenge. And the way DHL employed some of the generative AI processes is that they use that data of real-time traffic, weather patterns, and based on that, their algorithm that they wrote was adjusting their delivery schedule or the route optimization constantly. You may have felt this yourself. For example, if you are an Amazon customer, which most of us are, you may have seen sometimes that there is a certain delivery date and time specified on your Amazon delivery, and then suddenly it changes and you will say, okay, now your package will not come between 10 a.m. and 12 a.m., but it'll come between 3:45 and 4:45 in the afternoon. So that is happening dynamically in the background because maybe there was a traffic jam, maybe there was a major accident. So this tool is basically using that information to continuously optimize the routing for the delivery drivers so that they are using less fuel and they are not wasting as much time as they would have if this was not dynamically getting updated. So that's how DHL also implemented this. And clearly, they got some great results on enhanced customer satisfaction metrics. Clearly affects your customer service when things come on time and there are no delays. So this is a very good example of how generative AI can be used as an intelligent tool to optimize one of the most costliest parts of your supply chain operation. The second example is something which is close to my heart a lot because I have worked on similar projects on and off as well. And this one is the demand and inventory optimization at Walmart. So in this particular case, the way this works is AI tracks demand patterns and inventory levels continuously. So if you think about the Walmart supply chain, they've got hundreds of stores around the country and the inventory levels are constantly changing. Right? So there is a lot of data being generated all the time. And this is one of the beauties of supply chain, guys, that there is so much data supply chain is generating every single second, you know, pallet movements and movement of trucks, someone pulling a product from the shelf. All of these are data points. So if you have these smart engines and so smart ability to crunch that data, which really generative AI, and we'll talk about agentic AI in the next video, is bringing, you can really take your supply chain to the next level. And inventory optimization is probably one of the other areas in the industry where there is a constant drive to optimize this, because if you don't have the right level of inventory in supply chain, two things happen. First of all, your service suffers, so your case fill rate or your on-time info OTIF goes down. Second thing is that you are keeping inventory in the wrong location, which means that your cash is tied up in the wrong place. So it also has a big financial impact as well. Therefore, there is so much work happening in this inventory optimization space using some of these generative AI techniques. So coming back to the Walmart example, they use all this data. There is something called smart reallocation in this model, where based on that continuously updated data, the AI algorithm automatically redistributes the warehouse stock based on the predictions. It also balances stock levels and the fulfillment process. And then, of course, clearly the impact is faster delivery, reduced waste, and improved operational efficiency. The third example is from the world of procurement. And procurement is, of course, very much a part of supply chain as well. If you go back to the SCORE model, which I've covered in a lot of different videos, we have got plan, source, which is procurement, make, deliver, and return. So let's talk about this example, which was developed by a company called C3 AI. And I think this was done for a manufacturing client as well. And in this case, they are basically using the generative AI algorithm to streamline their process flows in purchasing. So the way this works is they are doing spend analytics. So automated analysis of procurement spending. So they're looking at, the algorithm is looking at the spending patterns and how the company is spending money in different contracts and different procurement suppliers and so on. And it's using that data to smartly do negotiations with the suppliers. So it's providing more automation when it comes to the supplier negotiation, which of course, if you are procuring a lot of different raw materials, which I think is very common to the industry that this example is coming from, you could be working with hundreds of suppliers at the same time. There's a lot of, once again, mass data which needs crunching and which needs to be made a meaning out of. So that's where the supplier negotiations come in. And then it's basically reducing that massive amount of workload on the team, because now the procurement teams don't have to go through lots and lots of paperwork, go through lots and lots of suppliers. It's basically simplifying the life of the procurement managers. I actually posted another very similar example like this in one of my articles on LinkedIn a few months ago, where I talked about how Unilever is using this generative AI technology to filter out a lot of quotations in their RFQ processes. So basically, Unilever's example there is very similar to how the HR industry is using these AI bots to filter out resumes. So some of you who are applying for jobs may very well know this, that nowadays, before your CV is seen by a human being, there are a number of AI bots who are filtering that out. Why are they doing this? Because each time you post a job, so you can receive up to 500 resumes, right? And that's a lot of resumes to go through. So these AI algorithms, what they do is they will take your job description, they will crawl through all the different resumes, and they will filter out maybe 10 from those 500, which then somebody in HR is going to look at and they will filter out. I actually made a video on this and how you can optimize your resume for AI chatbots, which you can watch by clicking over here. I know it's a slightly different topic, but when I looked at that particular execution from Unilever, it just reminded me of that, because Unilever is doing the same thing that the HR industry did for resumes to the quotations that are coming from the supplier. So they have replicated the same model in their RFQ process, so that if they got, let's say, 500 quotes for a raw material or for any service that they're getting, then that AI algorithm is going to probably filter out maybe 10 or 15 or whatever. And those filtered out quotations, so those filtered out proposals, sorry, will go for the procurement managers to take a deeper look on. And that's where they can put their human intelligence into picture. Now, coming back to this particular example with the C3 AI, in this case also, they delivered a 25% cost reduction, 40% improvement in service, and 3x resilience. Now, talking about the human intelligence piece, which I was just alluding to a second ago, this is where it brings me to the last point of this video, which is, if you look at all these different implementations, and I know we have taken a very quick look at these in this video, there are four key lessons that come out which need to be at the back of your mind as a supply chain professional, either if you are selecting a project for AI or you are in the middle of the implementation. Number one is human judgment. AI alone cannot solve the world's problems, at least for now, right? So whether you are using it in a supply chain project or whether you are using AI for content creation, you will have to put your human intelligence in. You cannot take the output of AI blindly and then go with it, because that can be a huge disaster. And there have been so many examples. One of the examples I maybe want to quote here is, recently there was this big case against Air Canada, where one of the AI bots they were using provided wrong information to one of their customers who was trying to book a flight. And that almost became a court case. I don't know. I don't think the financial implication of that was huge. However, it was a classical example of what can happen if AI goes wrong. So human judgment is very important. Another thing to keep in mind is it's a collaborative effort. So if you are bringing in an AI project, this will most likely require collaboration with people outside of your core supply chain group. So you might be working with finance or marketing and so on. So that's very important. The third one is the quality of data. As I mentioned earlier, garbage in, garbage out. So if you are exploring a project for an AI implementation, make sure that you have got good quality data, because if your data is not accurate, or it's crap, sorry for my bad language here, it is going to affect you. And then finally, change management. Change management is extremely important in any change you're driving, whether it's AI driven or not. And one change management which we often ignore is the people change management. So whether you are working on a project of any magnitude, a common mistake is that there is a lot of focus on systems changes and process changes. But what about people changes? Someone is doing a job today which will change as a result of the change you are bringing in. Have you thought about what will be the from and to state of the day in the life of that person? So those are the kind of things which need to be kept at the back of your mind when you are driving any change, because the people change management aspect is extremely critical, especially in the age of AI.